Yeah, these are the tough ones. Just on behalf of the family, all those of you who are able to be here, all those who are watching online that just weren't able to make the trip for one reason or another, the family is blessed by your presence and your love. I had to drag them away from, because they weren't going to let you in. They just kept hugging you and talking to y'all. So we weren't going to start until like 8 o'clock if I didn't drag them away. And that's just because of how much they appreciate you as family and friends, and how much you mean to Sherry and the family, and how much you meant to Roger, for sure. I'm going to start today off by saying this. I have known Roger personally for a lot of years. I love Roger. I miss him a ton, like all of us do. Nobody hugs like Roger, right? Nobody has that laugh, right? The Roger laugh. You know what I'm talking about. No one brings this crazy calmness into the room when they enter it like he did. And it was like a weird peace, you know? Because he would bring peace with him, but he was so wild at the same time that it was hard to explain that kind of peace that would enter the room when Roger would come in. So people ask me sometimes, they say, so Keith, is it harder or is it easier to do a funeral for service for somebody that you know and somebody that you love as much as you did Roger? And the answer, I think, is probably it's a little bit of both. It's harder because I just like you, I don't really like the thought of not being able to talk face to face with him anymore. I don't like the thought of not hearing verbally. I mean, I still hear it in my head, but not hearing verbally that laugh of his, and not feeling those strong handshakes, because he had man hands, you know, and he would shake like that. And I hate the thought of not being encouraged by him. He was always encouraging, and he'd tell you when he needed to tell you something different, but he was always encouraging about things. And I even miss being antagonized by him. Because he would do that game a lot. And missing those kinds of things for the remainder of our days, for me, like you, is the reason that a moment like this is the hardest to be a part of. It's what makes it challenging. But there's also a reason why it's a little bit easier to lead a service like this. And even though it's somebody that you miss and you love so much, because I know exactly what Roger wants from me and expects from me today. Roger had no problem telling you what he had in mind, and even a moment like this is no exception. I know what he wants from me, so I know what to share with you. So I'm going to tell you this. How we're going to approach today's service is a little bit different than I might normally approach a service because I know exactly what Roger wants from me. You see, normally what we would do in a funeral service is we would take a little bit of time to mourn and cry and hurt really, really deeply together as a unit. And then after that, we would take some time to talk about the person. And then I usually close the service up by talking about their relationship with God, where they are now, their eternal home, and how God has prepared that for them. Today, we're not going to do it that way. We're done with the morning stuff. It's tough. Roger'd have our heads if we cried too much. Well, a little bit, I think he'd let us do. But then he'd say, enough. So we're not going to spend much time there. Instead, we're going to focus on what Roger wants us to focus on. I actually almost wore a Bills jersey today. I know, Dawn's like, you should just wear it. And I couldn't quite do it, but he would have been okay with that, you know? But we're gonna talk first about Roger's relationship with God. And that's what Roger would want us to do right away. With all the joy and the laughter that defined our husband, our dad, our grandpa, our good friend, for some of us, our hero, probably for most of us. And he had that laughter and he had that joy, and we're going to talk about that today. So let's start by answering this question together. And this is a tough one, but we ask it. He wasn't young, he wasn't old enough to be gone yet. Why did he have to leave us so soon? It's one thing when somebody is who's terrible to society or hard on their family or somebody that nobody likes leaves us. It doesn't hurt so much. But Roger was, he was awesome. And why did he have to die so early? And I'm going to be honest with you, I'm not sure that I have all the answers to those questions. But maybe there's one reason that I could show you from the Bible that might help us bring a little bit of an understanding as to why one of the great ones would be taken home so early from this earth. Listen to these words. Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 1. God says this. He says through his prophet Isaiah, he said, you know what happens? The righteous, they perish. But no one really takes that to heart, and the devout are taken away. And no one understands this, that the righteous are taken away to be spared from evil. You see, those who walk uprightly enter into peace. And listen to this. They find rest as they lie in death. There's no doubt that Roger loved life. He found joy in it. Yet there's also no doubt that life was getting progressively more difficult for him. In conversations with Sherry, we talked about that most of us didn't realize that it was getting harder and tougher for Roger just to do some of the daily things that he had done. And he would get a little bit more tired quickly. I know he was so excited about teaching children's church class. He couldn't wait to get in there and teach kids. But what, you know, Sherry and some of the family knew is how exhausted he would be afterwards. Now, he was so doggone stubborn that he wouldn't let anybody know, of course, that he was exhausted about things, because you know that was Roger. He was going to go do it. But it was getting tougher on him. So we read that verse in Isaiah about entering into peace and finding rest, and God mercifully taking us to be into our eternal home. And we realize sometimes that God's greatest mercy and grace comes at that moment. Now, I'm going to admit something to you today that I probably shouldn't. That I may have had responsibility in making Roger's life a little bit more difficult a time or two on him. But let's face it, at times Roger could be such an antagonist, and he was so much fun to be around that we would find entertainment in making his life a little bit more difficult by antagonizing back. Things like dressing him up like a cow for a church function just seemed like a good idea at times. Or how about his grandchildren, what they did to him, dressing him up as a woman, putting a dress on him and some makeup on him, and then doing his hair. But the time I think I really tortured him was a story that I have to tell you. But I'm going to admit this. I don't take full blame for this, because I didn't know the grand scope of what I was about to do to poor Roger. You see, Roger had certain items that he really treasured besides family and besides his God. He had a tractor and a motorcycle. And I went to the family party And somehow the family said, Keith, you got to get up on Roger's tractor and drive it around. They never told me Roger does not let anybody drive his tractor around. So I did, with their blessing, and maybe not so much of Roger's, but that wasn't the worst. Then they encouraged somebody else, poor Kenny, to get up on his motorcycle and drive that out the driveway and down the road. To which apparently Roger said something like, there goes all my stuff. Thank God for calming brownies, right, Cher? Man, was he fun to mess around with. But I wonder sometimes if we're the terrible ones that God rescued him from. We know better. But the reality is that that verse reminds us of a really, really important reality that God sees that we don't necessarily see. That Roger found incredible rest when he transitioned from his earthly body to his heavenly one to be with his Lord. And how I know that is the other thing that I know for a fact that Roger wants me to talk about today. And this moment right here where I explain to you about Roger means everything to him. I know what he cares about most because he told me and a bunch of other people too what mattered most to him. He loves every one of us, especially his family. Proud of you guys. Thought the world of you. Wouldn't shut up about you sometimes. Because he loves you. What I have to tell you right now is the deepest expression of Roger's love to everyone. This is how Roger would express his love so that you could understand the depth of it. He would quote this from the book of John in chapter 3 and verse 16. For God loves each of you so much that he sent his one and only Son, that if you will believe in Jesus Christ, you, like Roger, will not perish, but you're going to have eternal life through Jesus Christ. Eternity where Roger is now enjoying his eternal retirement home with none of the struggles that came with aging here. There's nothing that Roger wants you to know more than to know that he is safe and he is made complete and whole now. And for all of us to know how to experience that life like he is experiencing it. And this is how he knows. Listen to the words of Jesus Christ as he explains this to all the world by explaining it to a group of people. This is what Christ said. He said, listen, don't let your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, Jesus said, believe also in me. He said, my Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place I'm going, Jesus told his disciples and these people. And Thomas, one of his disciples, looked at him and said, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered with these words. He said, Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am that way. Nobody comes to the Father, but they do through me. We talked about the difficulty of Roger being in the hospital room all by himself those last days. A common conversation we're having in situations lately. And what we know is this. He was never alone in that room. He was never abandoned. He was never by himself, even when his loved ones could not get in there to see him. Because Jesus Christ promised that he would be there with him and he would bring him. And he brought Roger home with him to that special home that Jesus made for him. and he got his motorcycle back. Don't you wonder, how could Roger be so confident about this? Because he was confident. He knew Christ had him. He told people. He told everyone he could. Well, Jesus was asked that about that confidence and knowing what's going to happen to someone. And when he actually experienced a situation Jesus did where somebody he loved passed away. And he talked to the family of those that loved, that of this person that died that he even loved. And one of them was this lady named Martha. It was the man's sister. And Lord, this is what it says in the Bible. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, listen, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus looked at her and he said, listen, your brother will rise again. And Martha answered, she said, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said this, these words to her, this is great. He said, I am that resurrection and I am that life. The one who believes in me will live, even if they die, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never really die. And he looked at her and he said, do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. Jesus told him, you can be confident because I am the resurrection from the dead and I am life and you can be confident in me. That's what Jesus told him. Be confident in me. I am life. I've got it. And that's exactly what Roger believed and knew. I mean, he knew it for a fact. That Jesus is life. And even when we die, we live. How? How do we live when we die? Because Jesus Christ died and shed his blood on that cross. So that blood, his blood, would pay for everything we've ever done wrong against our God. And all sins against God are forgiven by Jesus Christ because he paid for them when he shed his blood. And then he rose from the grave so that he could prove when he said, I am life, that he meant it and he really conquered death. So that when a person like our beloved Roger met that last moment and that last breath here on earth, he could be fully confident that Jesus Christ was there to carry him home because Jesus Christ is alive and he conquered death when he shed his blood on that cross. Roger knew that from September 6th, 1996. That was the moment that he came to Christ. He said, I believe that. And from that moment on, he knew he would never have to walk alone again. He would never be alone again because Christ was there with him in all those moments. Roger placed his faith in Christ to carry him through, and he started a relationship with Jesus where Roger would talk and walk with him in a real and personal way. So this is a song that we're going to sing together in a minute here that he fell in love with, just absolutely fell in love with, because it talks about walking with Jesus and talking with Jesus, even through life, but now even more so, especially since he went and met his best friend eye to eye. And he's walking with him and talking with him still, like he did before.
Stand and join us as we sing this together.
I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God. speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet. The birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other I'd stay in the garden with him. Oh, the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the
you may be seated. I can hear him singing that with that deep voice of his.
Do you remember when he gave his testimony?
I have some of it in front of me right here.
That was the longest church service in the history of the world.
Yeah.
I don't know if any of you remember. This was back in the other sanctuary. And the leadership at church was supposed to be every month or so, one of the deacons or elders was getting up and giving their testimony. And Roger mistook that for a Billy Graham crusade.
Yeah, he went.
It was awesome.
I think we had to finally clear him off
there. We did. Yeah. We had to get the hook out. But yeah. It was so awesome.
It was so good.
It was moving. It was real. It was Roger. It was so good.
In a minute, Jen's going to actually sing another song that Roger loved. And it's funny that Larry says that. He loved it because it talks so much about how his Savior changed him. And it's the Savior that Roger loved so much, the Savior that changed his soul. It changed who he was as a person. But I'm actually going to read. That was good, because I'm going to read just a little bit of Roger's testimony he gave even before the one in church. This is one he gave in Colesville, and it was shorter then.
Well, it grew. And then,
but he added, but listen, listen to what he says, because he would want everyone to understand this. On September 6, 1996, Roger said, that was the day of my salvation. He said, that alone I could write a book about my encounter with Jesus Christ. And he did share with us a book afterwards. In his testimony, he went on to write some stories of things that Christ had done for him after he became saved, and just the amazing way that Jesus was working in his life. I mean, just real practical things that Christ was making happen for him. And then he said this. He said, God blows me away in so many ways. He said, through the years, I've learned to walk with and get to know Jesus. Life has been one blessing after another. Yes, he said, Jesus has helped me with monetary things many times. But the joy of the Lord, he said, is by far my greatest gift that God gave me. He says, to know him is to love him, and to love him, it's overwhelming. Thank you, Jesus. And he signed his name. Some of you may not know this, but when Roger was younger, he wasn't necessarily the nicest person in the world. Okay? Right, Sherry? No, don't answer that. No, you can't answer that. He had quite the past. But it didn't matter. His past didn't matter because Jesus Christ rescued him from anything that he did, whether he thought it was wrong or it genuinely was wrong. And Roger was filled with joy from that moment when he decided to trust Jesus Christ. And he built that relationship with him. In fact, he was given such a different heart by Jesus. He told me once, he said, Keith, he said, I was the guy who never cried, ever. You couldn't make me cry. And then after that, Roger, after Christ worked on his life, Christ had to do a pretty big work there. And then that guy would cry at the drop of a hat, right? To the point that he actually had this sweatshirt, right? This guy loves Hallmark Christmas movies, was the shirt that he would wear around. Because the change, the profound change that Christ had made in his life. Now, we wonder if he actually did it because all the ladies in the store would come up to him and talk to him about that shirt. Might be. But anyway, the reality is this, man, Christ did such a work in his heart that he would cry at those cheesy movies. But he was so thankful for the healing and the joy that God just filled him with. That's what Christ does. And he would offer it as praise to his God, the one who rescued his soul, the song that Jen's about to sing. He loved it because it just speaks and sounds like his heart crying out to his God. Can see why he loved that song, huh? All right. Let's take a minute and do something. And I want us to talk a little bit about Roger. Because I want us to transition just to thinking about him and some stories of him for a bit. But here's the truth. Before we do that, I gotta say this. It would mean nothing would mean more to Roger than if anyone here does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ like he had. Or you don't understand what that's all about. That if today, on the day that we gather to celebrate his life, on the 48th anniversary of his marriage, that if you came to know Jesus Christ like he knows Jesus Christ. And if you don't understand that completely, you can come talk to me. You can talk to Sherry. Any of them that were here, Pastor Matt, Pastor Caden's here. Find someone. Grandkids. We all want to tell you. So you come find us. So we can tell you who Jesus Christ is and what he's done. Because that's what Roger would want. Now let's take a minute and have some fun with Roger. Because that's what he would tell us that he wants us to do next. And we might cry through sharing some of these stories. We might laugh through sharing some of these stories. But we sure are going to be thankful for that big teddy bear that we had to rub shoulders with and hug and spend time with. Before we share any of those, I'm going to start you with a little bit of a video. And this video will take you back down memory lane and prime us to be able to just share a few stories, and I'll open the mic in a little bit.
Thank you.
I offered to give Dave a kiss on the cheek like Roger did, and he said no. You know, it's funny. Let me just talk real briefly about Roger. And I know we say this a lot, but he could be so funny, stubborn at sometimes, which sometimes was a great trait, right? Because he would no doubt stand up for what was right. And he always stood for what was right. It might have meant his stubbornness that he would never admit that that recliner he had was kind of junk and he shouldn't have bought it in the first place. The spring marks and the bruises weren't even enough to get him to admit that. And that stubbornness is the reason you had to hide oars in that boat and only tell your grandchildren, because he wouldn't admit the thing was going to break down, but thankfully that the oars were there so that they would have a way to get back home again. Oh, that boat. That stubbornness was probably the thing that caused one particular daughter, who's going to remain nameless, she told me the story. She put peas in his boots one day because he told her she had to finish all the food at the table. And she had about enough of finishing her food, so she put the peas in his boots. And yeah, he found out when he put his foot inside there. But he wanted to make sure you guys grew up doing the right thing. And he succeeded. He loved his country music. But his fun but antagonistic nature actually kind of got him in trouble with one of his grandchildren one time. Because he might have antagonized her so much she said some things she shouldn't have said to her grandfather. And boy, was that a moment. Right, Amber? I mean, right? Don't ask me about it, ask her. Oh man, he was such a kid, wasn't he? Wasn't Roger like such a kid with certain things? Like Christmas time, he just absolutely loved Christmas. He loved getting presents. He was one of them people who has no problem to give presents to. He loved it. He loved the Christmas elf coming to visit him. Loved telling his grandchildren stories. He's a tree wolf, right? That's going to be around. Giving people nicknames. I did not know this. He probably had some for me. You guys aren't going to tell me if he had a nickname for me, right? I won't tell the nicknames. He made shirts with nicknames, but I can't talk about those things right now. But he was entertaining, and those things that he did was just full of laughter and full of joy. Until he called you a crow, right, Sherry? That might have been a nickname a little bit further than he should have gone. Isn't it great to laugh with Roger? And we can, because he lived that joy. He loved helping people. Just loved being there and helping out and making people laugh and doing whatever he could to make sure that people felt the joy that he had. He wanted people to feel that joy and the love of Christ in their lives. And he impacted people. That's why I think it's going to be wise to take a few moments and just hear, hopefully a few of you, just a few of you will share a little bit of memories. But I have some memories in front of me that people shared that I just want to tell you about. We actually asked somebody at church to make refreshments for the time that we're going to have in the other building afterwards, and this is what she said about him when we asked her to do that. She said, "Oh, he was always the hall monitor." He said, "When I was doing children's church check-in, he always had a smile and a great conversation. Last time I saw him, he told me before the service and after the service that he had dinner with his grandchildren for his birthday. He was so happy about it. What a wonderful man he was," said Chelsea. You were telling me that the banker, when they told the banker that he had passed away, the banker just walked away and cried. But that's the impact, right, that he had on the people that saw him regularly. Brett Simpson said this about Roger. I'm just going to read it. He said, "Roger, I'll never forget your stories, your sense of humor, your charisma, and your laugh. There are too many good memories of you to list. You were the person who introduced me to the great game of golf, the worst game in euchre, and my wife was your woman. May you rest in peace. I hope you're hitting them straight and long in heaven." And Lauren, his wife, or better known by Roger as the good-looking woman, said, I was too young to really remember too much of my own grandfathers before they passed, and I'm very blessed that I married into this family and I was able to have a connection with this amazing man. From the moment I met him, he showed me acceptance, love, and genuine happiness. I always look forward to seeing your big, jolly smile and hearing your one-of-a-kind laugh. May you rest in peace and watch over us. Love always, your woman. And Bree said this, she said, you gave me a second home. It was a place I felt safe, a lifetime of childhood memories that cannot be replaced. You gave me my first love, Kayla, and to this day, I am thankful, said, that you have helped teach me to love and to forgive. You show me God does not judge but loves all his children. Your laughter and jokes will always be with me, but most of all, I know you'll be looking down on me. I always feel your touch on my shoulders when I feel warmth, and I'm blessed to be part of your family. Thank you for being you. Love, Bree Ellison and Michelle. I want to give you a moment just to share some memories. They might be tough and they might be funny, but it's going to be a little challenging because we want you to hold the mic because there's people watching online, family members that would like to hear just a couple memories. We don't have much time, really don't have much time. So Pastor Matt Gold is going to start us out. He, by the way, this is the guy that gives almost as good of hugs as Roger did. So,
almost. What a guy. Seriously. And most of you know him or you wouldn't be here. And so many of the things rushed through my head as Keith asked me a few days ago to be the roving reporter tonight. So I'm coming to you, so you better be ready. Two things stuck out. We went on a mission trip to the Dominican Republic. Woo! And I didn't know if Roger was going to come back with us. I can be really honest with you. I've never seen anybody get so sick. I won't go into any more detail, but he got sick. And it was funny because everybody went pew! And I got stuck there rubbing Roger's back. And I was hoping to see on the screen a picture of his little Big Mac container that he used to pull behind his, that's what I called it, behind his motorcycle. Because Roger and I shared two loves. We loved motorcycles and we loved to golf. So he goes, let's ride our motorcycles to go play golf. I'm like, really? How do you dress to ride your motorcycle and golf? Well, we figured it out, but there's one thing, and if you've ever golfed with Roger, you've heard this noise before. Oh, after every single shot, because Roger thought he was a really good golfer. And he would say, Pastor Matt, I'm going to beat you today. I'm like, okay, Rog. But we had so much fun. And I love to hear, and this is so true, he was a man after God's own heart. He loved the Lord. He loved people, and he loved his family, and it was very, very evident. So, you know me, I can talk all day, but it's your turn. So, who's next? Raise your hand. I'm coming to you. Okay, somebody else. All right, I'm going way back there. I don't know how I got this job, but.
Thank you. I'm actually taking the mic on behalf of my wife, because I know she's too shy that she'd pick it up. But my Aunt Joan passed a couple years ago, and we used to talk about what big, slobbery, wet kisses she would give. And so my wife, Andrea, she would say, listen, you don't know a slobbery kiss until you kiss Roger Griffiths. So, but now I think, Roger, both you and I would agree that I'm glad I don't have the experience to know the difference between the two. But I gave Roger a call a couple weeks ago when the family was in a bout with COVID, and he's just a man who takes care of his family. And that was the last conversation I had with Roger, and he was just doing everything that he could do to make sure that his family was well provided for. So that's the last memory I'll take with me.
All right, I'm going to talk about my daughter, too, since he was able to. It was probably around 1999 that Roger and Sherry had us up to their house several times, and Andrew was 9, and our son was 11. It's the first time we ever played Phase 10, and my kids loved going to Roger and Sherry's house and having game night with them. And so now when Roger would come to church every Sunday, and Andrea, who's now the mother of Ella, and Ella is 9 and looks just like her mother, and Roger would come in and say, "There's the twins," because he knew her when she was 9. So we just love the man, and, you know, I just always felt so loved by him, too.
Next. Do you want me to start preaching? Next. Anybody? Okay.
Don't do it. Don't give her a mic. I should have warned you, brother. I'm sorry.
Because Roger used to always look at me and he'd go, "Shh." Roger, Teddy, I love you. I always will. I miss you so much.
Anyone else?
Roger was, we live right around the corner, and he's probably closer to us now than he was then. But he was always there to help, and he did numerous times. He'd come over on his motorcycle one day, beautiful day. I thought it was Roger. So Beth and I went out. We're talking with him, and I said, "Roger," I says, "You all right?" "Oh, I'm having a little reaction," because he was diabetic. I said, "Roger, I don't think you had," because we know about diabetes. Beth says, "Roger, you're having a pretty bad reaction." I said, "Roger, you're on a motorcycle." He said, "I know that. I'm not having that much of a reaction." I said, "Well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to give you a ride home." He says, "How are you going to give me a ride home on a motorcycle?" He goes, "And you're not driving my motorcycle." I said, "No, I'll give you a ride in my car. And then when you're better," he's better. Wait a minute. He reaches in the back in his pouch, brings out a baby Ruth, takes a big bite, and went down the driveway. I said, "My God, he's having a reaction. He's riding a two-wheel motorcycle." The next time we saw him, everything was fine. But that was Roger, so I didn't get to drive his motorcycle.
All right, one more.
One more.
Well, I'll combine the golf and the diabetes, because I had both with him. I took him up to play golf with me. I was on his motorcycle. I don't know how he fit both sets of clubs in the back of his stupid little thing there and made me get on the bike with him, which that was weird. That was weird. So we go to play golf, and we're playing, and we hit a few shots, and Matt wasn't kidding. I don't know if – is anyone else here besides the two of us and Tim, has anybody else played golf with him? There's no doubt that he was awful, right? I mean, I love the man, and I know he had to play well sometime because he always used to tell us about the time before how well he was doing. Because he wasn't doing that well when he was with us. But he loved it, but golf is kind of neat in that it doesn't matter if you're any good enough. If you enjoy it, you enjoy it, and that's all that matters. And he loved to play. So, yeah, we're up at Shellridge and Medina playing, and we're on the 10th hole, and he kind of looks at me and goes, I don't feel so good. What's wrong? Then nothing. Just kind of sat there and started staring like, you know, you get a little low on the sugar. That's what they do. So headed over 4 different fairways across a couple greens, got to the clubhouse, got a couple candy bars, finished the round. Life was good. He wasn't going to stop just because of that.
Listen, I know some of you are a little bit more shy than others. You could talk about them all day. When we get over there, I suggest when you're sitting at the table, you just tell some stories about them, because there's a lot, and they're good. And they're good because Roger connected with people so well and just loved being around all of us so much. There's so much about him that he loved. He loved his God first. He loved his family second. And with no less passion, Roger Griffiths loved his country that he served. And we're honored to have with us today representatives from the United States Air Force that are going to celebrate the life of someone who loved his country as these two love their country. And it's an honor to know that he and others serve such a great land as we live in. And we're going to take just a few moments and celebrate his life and his service. I'm going to close our time before we hear one last song with this from Sakina. There's a picture that she has. And with this picture in mind, she said these words. She said, "These people are the ones to raise me. They made me the person I am today. They showed me my morals, my manners, and how to be a kid. My best childhood memories, but I have lost one of them. His name was Roger Griffiths. You see, they took me into my home when I was 4, and they raised me as their own. Still to this day, I talk about them and call them Grandma and Grandpa. I don't know what life would have been like if I didn't have them. I always think about if I could go back and be with them one more time. I never get the chance to tell him how much of an influence he was on my life, teaching me right from wrong and making me laugh and teaching me how to swim and going to work with him and showing me how things worked. I miss smelling the Old Spice and seeing him get ready every morning. He would have his Cheerios and his English muffin. He would read his daily Bible lesson. And I remember I would watch him go to his room and put on his Old Spice and sit down at the end of the bed, put his boots on, and then kneel down and pray. And then he would take his lunch pail, kiss Grandma, and go to work. And he did that every day. Looking back and watching all those things he did, he was a true man of God in everything he did. And I am proud to call him Grandpa. Roger, we're proud to call you friend. We are blessed to have had him in our lives. And we finish now by listening to another song that he absolutely 100% loved, about the reality that we're currently experiencing. Actually, the reality he's currently getting to experience. And that we wait to experience it because of the blood of Jesus Christ. To all those who believe, we too will one day be able to experience what he's experiencing. But for now, as the song says, we can only imagine it. But he's up there doing it. As Shannon said, when he got there, she imagined it was like two best friends, Roger and Jesus, because he no longer has to imagine.
Standing in the sun, I can
only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Will all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I I can only imagine.
Permit me to bring you before God's throne. Let's bow. Father, we're going to admit that this is a little challenging because sitting here or watching online are a bunch of people that can only imagine. And Roger is getting to experience that moment where he's with you, able to praise your name with nothing getting in the way, no hurts, no pains, no frustrations. You've made him whole. But God, we only see it from this end. We don't see it from your side. So for us, what we see is we've lost. We know that you have gained, but it's that loss that just hurts. So what we're asking you together, God, as a group of people and who just love Roger, we're asking you that somehow you would fill that hole in our hearts. And I know you'll use family and people, and thankfully you'll use the blood and the grace of Jesus Christ to do that. But just fill us with your peace. Give us the kind of love for Christ that Roger had. Fill us with the kind of joy that he experienced. May we treat others like he did. We might want to be a little better at our golf game, maybe. But God, we sure do. Thank you for so many good things that he taught us. We pray that you'll just fill us with the peace that comes from the Holy Spirit, through the blood of Jesus Christ and our belief and trust in you. We praise you that we had time. Even if it was only 47, 48 years, it might have been too short. But we're thankful for the time we've had with one of your great ones. Now bless us, bless the family, and may your name continue to be glorified because of the work that this man did on earth for you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. I would invite all of you. There is some coffee and refreshments and many stories for you to share with people at your table. There's some tables set up so you can get coffee, refreshments, sit with people that maybe you're familiar or comfortable with. And just go over to the other room and do that, and that'll give you a chance Just a moment. We'll give the family just a brief moment here, and they would like to meet you over there and enjoy that time of refreshments. So I would encourage you from the back rows forward to go ahead and stand up, and you'd be welcome to go over and have those refreshments. And we'll just give the family just a moment, and then they'll be over there, and then you can be an encouragement to them as well.